In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. Welcome to St. Paul Servant Preparation Course. Today we're going to have a lecture in the Comparative Theology. We're going to talk about the Mennonite, the Amish, and we're also going to examine the United Church of Christ. So let's get started. Comparative Theology, Part 5. Other Christian denominations. Objectives for this lecture: to learn about the Mennonite, to study the Amish belief, and to examine the United Church of Christ. Let's start by the Mennonite. This movement started in the 16th century. It's basically a subdivision of the Anabaptist Church. So the Anabaptist Church was a church that arose in Europe, and basically they rebaptized everyone who came from the Catholic Church. That's how they get their name, Anabaptist, or re-baptizing new member. This movement started by someone named Menno Simons. He lived from 1996 till 1561. He was a Catholic priest in Holland and Netherlands. Ironically, he never read the Bible before his priesthood ordination. So that tells us he doesn't have a solid background in the Bible. But he have enthusiasm, he have passion, he have zeal, and he's gonna start a new movement. So he basically rebelled against the Catholic Church and joined the Protestant Reformation movement. And he became rebaptized since he joined the Rebaptist Church in October 1536. He focused his mission on Bible study and social peace. He rejected infant baptism, and he believed that salvation is by faith and prayer only. So no need for sacrament, no need for life of repentance, no need for good deeds, just faith and prayer. This is him, Menno Simons. This is the area of Holland from yellow. And at this time, it actually was very famous for its naval ship. So the people from Netherlands used to travel across the world. The Mennonite, they gather in communities. They reject the outside world, they reject violence, and refuse to take oaths. They worship in meeting houses, not the churches. They don't build church, but they build meeting houses. And they basically support separation between the church and the state. They are very peaceful, harmless, and they have been persecuted from the Catholic Church. The Russian government invited him to live in Ukraine, to farm the land in exchange for religious freedom and military exemption. So they travel across Europe till they settle down in Ukraine. However, later on, when the Russian Revolution came, they suffered persecution and were forced to exile. Some of them went to Serbia, some went to Canada, North America, and Latin America. In Pennsylvania, most of them live around Lancaster County, and some live around South Central Kansas. So this map illustrates the movement of those people, the Mormon, from the area of the Netherlands across Europe all the way down to Ukraine. They start moving from 1546 till 1770. After that, because of the Russian Revolution, they were forced to exile and they moved west. So some of them moved to Canada, some moved to North America, some came down to South America, to Paraguay. So what they believe in? Only two sacraments, as most of the Protestant church: baptism and communion. They allow marriage, they allow divorce only for sexual immorality. Their women are very conservative, they wear head covering, and their men have beards. They encourage planned marriage from the same church, so they like to grow as one community, so you allow the younger generation to marry one another. They have their own school and their own college, and used to be doing a small job like farming, construction, carpenting, and so on. Later on, they start to go into regular schools and colleges, and some of them became professional. Now, they are very known for charity work and helping other people in disaster. So this is how they look like. The girls have head covering, the men have beard, they all full clothed. They always there when there's time of disaster across the world, regardless of the religion of the people in affliction, So this is a picture helping the Syrian and African refugee, helping African nation in time of turmoil. They are very famous for building homes. Next, we're going to talk about another group who are very related to the Mennonite. They are the Amish. So the Amish appeared in the 17th century. Mennonite in the 16th, the Amish in the 17th century. It started by a man named Jacob Amen in 1693 from Switzerland and South Germany. He started to make a reformation for the Mennonite people to have a simpler life. So they are subdivision of the Mennonite, but basically a very simpler life. The followers are called the Amish. They dress in simple clothes, work in very simple jobs. They refuse technology. They don't encourage electricity or phone line. They try to stay away from civilization and don't allow blood transfusion, thinking that this maybe carry something from the world. So they stop getting blood transfusion. And that actually some of them might prefer to die than take a blood transfusion from non-Amish person. This is Jacob Amen, the leader of this group. They came from the area of South Germany. This is a famous buggy because they don't like to use cars. They don't like photographs. They don't like somebody take picture of them. I don't like to take picture of anyone. They usually have something called the mud sale when they sell their own product. And products are very simple. It could be a quilt, could be some jam, some simple product that made at home. They have choirs for single hymn without music to try to stay away from all instrument. They basically encourage group work. They prohibit any habit that feed individualism and greed. This is their picture, usually wedding held in the weekdays, different days than the rest of the Christian, usually Tuesday and Thursday. This is some of the product that they have in their mud sales. So the Mennonite or the Amish are a subdivision of the Baptist Church, appeared in the 16th and 17th century. They moved from Europe to America, settled down around Lancaster area in Pennsylvania. They basically have two sacraments, baptism and communion. They are very peaceful people. They try to avoid violence and crime. They always try to help other people in need, especially the Mennonite. Now let's examine the United Church of Christ. That name is very appealing, United and Church and Christ. But let's examine this church and we see, are they really Christian? Do they have the same criteria that all the Christians share or not? So this came in the 19th century. So we have the Mennonite 16, the Amish 17, the United Church in the 19th century. Again, many groups of the Protestant church decided they can be united together to form one big conference. So they have around 5,000 church in 1957 met together and formed what's known as the United Church of Christ. They met in conferences in America around, there are 38 conferences in the United States. The issue with this group, actually, they have a very open dialogue with many faith groups, include non-Christian. So they include members from the Jewish community, from the Muslim community. So they have, in addition to the Christian, they have Muslim and they have Jewish people. They have very liberal, open view in abortion, in women's rights, and in homosexuality. And that's why they try to be appealing to a big swath of people. They describe themselves as extremely pluralistic and diverse denomination. And they believe it's the will of God that every person accept his faith according to his own need. And every person is in a spiritual journey to reach God in a different path. So the Christian have its own path to reach God. The Jewish has his own path. The Muslim has his own path. Another people from different religion, they also have their own path. To them, all paths are correct. All paths are acceptable. They don't have any rigid formula of doctrine or creed because they include the Jewish and the Muslim, so you cannot share our Christian creed. And they basically say, we're preaching love and help to everyone. The most famous member was President Barack Obama, the 34th president of the United States. And that explained many of his unusual situation as a president. So why you object this Church of Christ? First of all, they have a pluralistic view that lead to loss of a church identity. If you include other members who are not Christian, then basically lost your identity as a Christian. You accept everyone for own religion, including non-Christian. Definitely, there is no practice of sacrament. There is no creed. There is no holiness. They accept homosexuality and abortion, which to us is considered sin. So they accept sinner as an active member of the church. They're mostly focused in social activity, like feeding the needy, sheltering homeless. So we actually you can look at it as a social organization, not a religion. It's a social organization. It's a charity organization, helping homeless people, helping poor people, helping maybe under covered age, under indigenous population, something like this, but not a church. This is their symbol. And they don't have a creed that matches the Orthodox creed. So they don't share our creed. They don't share our sacrament except baptism and communion only for the Christian member. The non-Christian don't take this sacrament. They don't believe that Christ is the incarnated God. They don't believe just Christ is the only way to heaven. So after all, they call themselves Christian. But do we really consider them as Christian if they don't believe in Jesus Christ as the incarnated God? If they don't believe that Jesus Christ is the only way to salvation? If they only do sacrament for subgroup of their own member? If they don't have our own creed? If they don't believe in the Holy Trinity? If they don't believe in the intercession? If they don't believe in the salvation through the blood of Jesus Christ? Can we call them Christian? They try to attach themselves to Christianity, but actually they are not Christian. So keep that in mind. United Church of Christ are not Christian. The name is very catchy. United, everybody want to be united. Church to attract people and Christ. But actually, they don't follow the teaching of Christ. They don't follow the dogma of the Christian churches and don't share our creed. So I don't think we should call them Christian at all. This was the objective for today's lecture. We talked about the Mennonite, the Amish, and we examined the United Church of Christ. Finally, I'd like to leave with some memorization verses that belong to this topic. From Mark, the Gospel of St. Mark, these people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. That apply very well to the United Church of Christ. Honor God with their lips, but their heart is far away from me. And in Galatians, first chapter, a very, very important command from St. Paul. But even if we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than what we have preached to you, let him be accursed, let him be anathema, let him be excommunicated. So if we came back to you or even an angel from heaven start to preach different doctrine, don't accept him. Don't let him to be part of your church or part of your congregation. Let him be accursed. That's how the church, especially the Orthodox church, kept up the face all the time. Whenever a new heresy came on the surface, they have a council, they decide in based on the gospel, based on the teaching of the father, preach and the doctrine, and they decide what's right and what's wrong. We, the Orthodox Church, kept the same face over the years. We didn't change it. I think that will cover this talk about the United Church of Christ. And thank you so much for your attendance. God bless you all. I'll see you next week, another topic about the comparative theology, and glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.